little kid, I was really into animals. I used to get a magazine with animal facts that I loved to share with everyone, sometimes at inconvenient times. I particularly liked insects, which are animals, and I got really good at identifying them. But not perfect, and I recall identifying a certain insect as a bee. It looked like a honeybee, had the stripes, it was on the flower, and I went into my monologue of bee facts to my father, who also is really into entomology. He quietly remarked that it was in fact not a bee. No, it was actually a bee fly, which is classified as a different order than bees. Generally, honeybees have four wings, he said. Most flies, like bee flies, have two, and bee flies will not sting like honeybees do. Just tricking everyone. My pride was a little devastated. I remember going to the library and painstakingly looking through books into which I found these branchy diagrams that classified bee flies in the order Diptera, whereas bees can be found in the order Hymenoptera. These mysterious branchy diagrams returned again many years later when I first took biology. Except that time, I learned the one I saw was called a cladogram, or cladogram. You may hear either pronunciation. The best way to introduce how a cladogram works, a hypothesis of relationships among organisms, is to try and build one. So from our animals video, I'm going to select some animals here from a few different phyla. A type of frog, a type of sea bunny, a type of lancelet, a type of shark, and a maned wolf. Now let's say I have a chart here that looks like this. Going to put the five animals in the chart, randomly arranged. Now I'm going to put some specific characteristics in this top row. First is a notochord. Animals in the phylum Chordata have this, at least at some point in their development. A notochord is a flexible rod-like structure that runs along the back. To add, for animals that are vertebrates, it's there at embryonic development but often gets replaced by vertebrae, although remnants can often still be found. One of these animals is not in Chordata and thus does not have a notochord. Which is it? It's a sea bunny. We'll put an X on the notochord indicating the sea bunny doesn't have one. But all the other animals, they have it. Check. Next, vertebrae. This is for the vertebrate animals. We know the sea bunny is a no. Now these remaining animals are in the phylum Chordata. Most chordates have vertebrae, but one of the chordates here does not and is technically an invertebrate chordate. Which one? The lancelet. X on that, but the remaining have a check. Next, lungs. Which of these animals have lungs? This frog does, as an adult anyway, and so does the maned wolf. None of the others. Last, hair. Who has hair? The maned wolf, Petunia's favorite animal. Hair is a classic mammal characteristic. None of the others have hair. Okay, so we got this chart. Now what? Let's build a cladogram. A diagram that serves as a hypothesis for possible evolutionary relationships among these organisms, based on these shared characteristics. I'm going to make a line and put the characteristics along here, starting with characteristics shared by all organisms in the group and moving to those shared by smaller groups. This is arranged using the most simple branching pattern, and it also reflects something called parsimony, meaning it is drawn using the fewest number of evolutionary changes for the characteristics listed. Now I'll add each organism based on the characteristics it has, placing each organism only after the characteristics it actually has. For example, the sea bunny has no notochord, so I'm placing it before that characteristic. The lancelet has a notochord but no vertebrae, so it goes after notochord but before vertebrae. The shark has both a notochord and vertebrae, so it goes past those two characteristics. Next, the frog. It has a notochord, vertebrae, and lungs. No hair, though. Finally, the maned wolf. It has all of my selected characteristics. It goes here. You can see that the organism only gets placed beyond the listed characteristic if it has the characteristic. Now it's time to talk about what we have done. The whole thing is called a cladogram, a hypothesis of possible evolutionary relationships built on specific characteristics that are present in some of these organisms but not in others, as those can be indicators of common ancestry. Each intersection spot here represents a node, an intersection that can represent a common ancestor. This branch here that stems off this node can be considered a clade. A clade includes a common ancestor and its descendants. So while it can be one branch here, a clade can also include more branches. Now to note, our cladogram is not to any specific kind of scale. Our line in our cladogram does not represent a time scale. Instead, our cladogram shows physical characteristics that these organisms may share and could show potential evolutionary relationships. The sea bunny doesn't share any of the listed characteristics with these organisms. If I'm looking at the lancelet, shark, frog, and maned wolf, I would consider the sea bunny, which does not share any of the listed characters here, is an outgroup. It has the least shared characters. In our example, it has none. If my focus is the lancelet, shark, frog, and maned wolf, the notochord is a shared ancestral character. All of them have a notochord at some point in their development. The ancestral species of these four organisms, right here at this node, had this notochord. In this cladogram, lungs are considered a shared derived character for this frog and maned wolf, indicating that this trait evolved in a common ancestor they share. Shared derived characters are not found in all organisms in a cladogram, which makes them useful for inferring how organisms may be related. This shared derived character can support that the maned wolf and frog share a common ancestor that had lungs is represented by the node. This also can support that, when looking only at the organisms we have, the maned wolf and frog share a more recent common ancestor with each other than either does with the shark. But when looking at a cladogram, sometimes students get a misconception. This cladogram does not support, for example, that this maned wolf evolved from a frog. Rather, they share a common ancestor. Remember, this cladogram is a hypothesis based on shared characters, but there are types of evidence we could use to build a better model, molecular evidence such as DNA or amino acid sequence data, for example. And that matters because there are some events, such as convergent evolution or a loss of traits, that could happen along the way that could make a cladogram, a hypothesis, inaccurate, with the need to make some changes. And while I use the simplest branching pattern possible for this cladogram, it isn't the only branching pattern that exists, and that is something to recognize. For example, notice how I could change the branching pattern here to look like this. And this branching rearrangement is still considered parsimonious. This cladogram still reflects the least amount of evolutionary changes, though it's not as simple as my linear branching pattern that I had done. But I want you to notice this rearrangement here because some students get a misconception and think that cladograms are showing different levels of evolution, thinking some of these are higher levels than others, but I rearranged to demonstrate that's not what cladograms show. Instead, they show how lineages diverge in common ancestry. I could even switch the maned wolf and frog here. These tips can rotate around this node without changing the evolutionary relationships they represent, as they both still branch from this node, the node representing their common ancestor in this cladogram. Also notice the tip near the lancelet. These tips can also be called terminal nodes, sometimes a bit confusing with the word node in it. For that reason, I prefer referring to them as tips. Anyway, notice how these two tips are close together. While those tips may be near each other, relatedness is not related to how close these tips are to each other in my cladogram. It's the internal nodes, as those internal nodes represent common ancestors. It's important to keep in mind that my cladogram only showed the organisms that I selected and the homologous characters I was tracing. Cladograms may not show other characteristics that evolved along lineages. Not only can cladograms have different branching patterns, as I mentioned, but I could even take our original cladogram and flip it over, as long as the evolutionary relationship still can be read consistently from root to tip. Cladograms also don't even have to be in a branching type of shape. For example, a circular cladogram is a thing. On that note, if you're exploring the different cladogram diagrams these can be represented in, there are a lot of programs that can build cladograms or phylogenetic trees. And I just said phylogenetic tree. A note on that term, it can be very common in conversation and textbooks to have the word cladogram used interchangeably with the word phylogenetic tree. Some sources use the term phylogenetic tree specifically when there is more detail. For example, the branch lengths are likely to be drawn intentionally to reflect a scale of time, and there's more data behind it, such as DNA data. Phylogenetic trees can be massive. Highly recommend a quick search for phylogenetic tree of bees and flies, and you'll see what we mean. The main point is that cladograms and phylogenetic trees help us visualize possible evolutionary relationships among groups of organisms. Building cladograms helps us practice how to group the organisms by evidence such as homologous structures or molecular data, and these models can be altered as we gather new data. To learn more about how this data can show evolutionary relationships, you can check out our video on evolution. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.